Hey, this is Kevin Kitchens of Once Upon a Game, and I'm going to set up and try to play through a scenario with Lock and Load Tactical Solo using Heroes of Normandy. So I'm getting it pulled out. The first thing you got to do is, this is just a pre-playthrough kind of commentary. So the first thing you got to do is pick a scenario. Now, this is using the old, not the old version, but the most recent version of Heroes of Normandy, where they publish the scenarios sequentially by timeline and not in order of introduction. And I know they're going to provide in the reprint, they're going to put a listing, I think, or resort them from recommended easiest to hardest. So they're going to do something somehow so it makes it easier to find. So I've chosen for this demo the Saving Brigadier Hill. Which took place on D-Day, scenario. It's two maps. I usually try to test things with one map because it's a smaller area, but it is a low counter density. I'm going to cover up the spoilers here in case you haven't played this one. It's a low counter density, and it is just infantry. There are no vehicles to add complications to the mix. I have started and stopped with the solo system, the lock and load solo, a few times, and keep getting frustrated. And I got some tips. Get a little frustrated on the spotting rules, forgetting that if a unit's not spotted, it's as if it's not there. So I would get a fire order, and I'd be like, well, how can you fire? We see that X, but we don't spot a unit. Well, it should be like the unit's not even there. If the hex is not spotted. So I got some advice from some other players and from the guys at Lock and Load, and going to try it again because it should work. Now, one thing that's different with this one versus the original version for Conflict of Heroes is that had canned scenarios, and this is meant to adapt to most of the scenarios that come with the Lock and Load games. There may be some with hidden units, things like that are going to be a little harder. But for the most part, they should work just fine. You still have to make a lot of decisions, and that's what I was going to talk about here before I've opened a box before, but I haven't got the cards yet and set up the solo stuff yet. Sorry. Oops. Spoiler. Whereas in Conflict of Heroes, it says, okay, you start the Germans or the Russians, whoever the AI is, starts here. This is where they start. Well, here you still have to make decisions. Like here, if they're going to play the British or the defenders, they set up anywhere on map 14. If they're the Germans or the attackers, they set up anywhere east of a road. I'm going to take this out of the way here. So they're going to set up anywhere east of this road here, and then they have to take some objectives that are here. There's also what I was covering up. There's also a event marker that'll happen when the Germans get in line of sight of it. So you have to decide who's the AI going to be. Are they going to be the defenders or the attackers? So the defenders, in a way, works best. They can just sit still because if they pass, if I as the defender pass and I'm going to trick the AI into passing, because I know something's not going to happen or whatever, and I don't know that's going to happen in this scenario because it's a larger map and they're probably going to have a lot of movement orders first. But you can trick them into if they end up passing and then you pass, well, the turn's over. So now I've advanced the turn clock and burned out some of the time. So whereas if I'm the attacker, it's in my interest to make sure I'm moving and getting to the objectives. So there are different cards for attack and defense, so that helps. It'll be probably more prone to move than attack if you're on the attack side, because if you can't fire, then you would move and get closer kind of thing. So, I mean, there's some intelligence built into it. But anyway, so still not fully solo in that it's going to tell you where to set up the German units or set up the British units, the AI or the human. So it just gets a little there's a little bit of frustration in my mind how that occurs, because I'm still having to make this decision now. So if I were playing against myself, two player, you know, solo, skit solo, however you want to say it, I would still be making that decision. So just beware if you're looking for a pure solo experience, that you're not gonna get that in that sense. You still have to set the board up and then move forward from there. So keep that in mind. And then there are times where you have to make a decision. The same thing happens in some of the scenarios I've tried where the units come in from off the board. I have to decide where's the best way to move them in. And there's some guidelines, but they're kind of vague, more common sense kind of thing. Like, you know, don't move them just right out in the open where he's going to get shot at, you know, kind of use cover if you can and stuff like that. But it's a limitation, I think, of what you have to have, given that this is trying to do so much at one time. So, anyway, the Germans have a lot more units in this one as the attackers. And the British obviously going to get fewer impulses. There's going to be a lot of passing until the appropriate time to take a shot. So, just going to have to make a decision, I guess, as to which one is the best one to do. Literally, they have three units. They have a Vickers machine gun, and we have a leader and a sniper. Lord Holmes, I believe it is. Hello, Holmes, how are you? And he's decisive. All right, they have a couple of foxholes they can put somewhere. Create a
train
modifier. The Germans, on the other hand, have seven of these guys, one of these guys, two of these guys, which I believe have assault move capability. In the scenario book, they have an AM next to them, so I believe that's it. They've got two leaders and a medic, and three MG-34 machine guns that they can distribute. So you have to make those decisions too. I mean, how am I going to group these guys? Who am I going to put with leaders? Who am I going to give machine guns to? So on and so forth. So it might be kind of like with the Conflict of Heroes firefight generator, that really you should just set them up as best you can, and then like flip a coin or roll a die and see which one you're going to play, and then let the AI take the other side. And that way it encourages you to set them up the best you can. Or you can just say, you know what, I'm objective enough to set them up the best I can and take it from there. So I don't know. I'll just make a decision here and set them up. But it's not going to be as cut and dried as just saying, hey, I'm going to do this. And this is where the AI wants to be. So you have to make those decisions. Now, it's possible that when this is released, that the community, which is very good for lock and load, will set up some recommended staging suggestions and say, well, if you're going to let the AI play the Germans in this scenario, they'll set up here. You know, this is what we recommend, kind of thing. And that would be pretty helpful. So I'm going to get the cards out and show you those and how those work, and then get back to you then. Thanks. Okay, so I set up the scenario using the obviously the order of battle provided, and just did my best. The target of the Germans, who are on the attack, is to control this hex and to make sure that there's no enemy within three, any good order units within three hexes, inclusive of this hex. So I put a little red marker on there to indicate the British currently control it. There's also a line of sight event. When the Germans get within line of sight of that, something happens. Probably some reinforcements or something like that. When the Germans control it, I'll throw a gray cube on there. So since that is the target, I've kind of set up a perimeter around it. You more experienced players are going to go, what an idiotic setup. But as I'm playing myself, it's probably equally idiotic on both sides, so who cares? So as we keep looking here, I've set up the leader, who has the deadly skill. No, he has the German has the deadly skill. This leader has the decisive skill, and he can activate twice
the units in his hex. So basically, they do one thing, and then another impulse, they can act again completely fresh. So I figured that with the Vickers machine gun, which has a range of 14, would be a plus. I've got the foxhole set up there. And where's the other foxhole? The other foxhole is back over here. To give a modifier on this side.
So the Germans are set up. They have to be set up east of this road that runs the whole length. All the so here's some hedges here. All the bocage here is treated as hedges, which basically means they're all out of line of sight right now, because that bocage runs all the way, which bocage also blocks line of sight, but it's easier. It's only a plus one modifier as a hedge to get over it. Plus, they don't get a movement penalty when they're fired upon for crossing a hedge. So that's one of the things you just got to remember. This is now a hedge. And that's, again, that's just the setup of the mission. It has nothing to do with the solo rules. Seems there was something else I was going to add. So I've grouped into four groups. I figure they would just kind of wave. These guys might try to take out this gun. These guys might use cover to sneak around. There's only one, it's two-story buildings. There's one down here, but I don't want to spread those forces too thin, getting him down here, and then there's one here. The British do have a sniper off board that can come into play. So again, what I was saying before is I've still got the conflict of do I let the AI play the attacker, or do I let the AI play the defender? And that determines how I'm going to set up the cards. I'll get all that out in a second and show you. But so I don't know, because there's so few counters. And it seems like the AI would never move, except to maybe close in on the objective. There's only the one objective. There's no points for occupying anything else. It's the control of that at the end of the game. I believe it's 8 turns. So 8 turns. British start with the initiative on turn one. So it's you know, what do I want to play? Do I want to play the attacker? Do I want to play the defender? And which is better for the AI to do? So, you know what? I guess I'm just going to roll a die here. And determine that. So we'll roll this. So we'll say what odds is German AI and even is British AI, and it's even. So the British will be the AI. So the British will be the defenders. And the British are the defenders, and that will be the AI. So I'll set up the deck here accordingly. See what happens. Okay. So to go over a little bit here about the AEO for the lock and load solo system. You've essentially got a deck of 54 cards, I believe. These are the larger, oversized cards. So you need special sleeves for them. These are quick printed. These are lesser quality than the ones you'll receive. But so once they're sleeved, they're pretty good though. So what you've got then is you've got standard cards that'll be in every game, and then you've got these cards that are marked with this attack icon, and that means they're for when they're the attacker. And then you got the defense icon that shows when they're defense. So what you'll do is you'll take all of these cards, and then whichever posture the AI is taking will make up the rest of the deck. So they're going to be the defenders, so we won't need the attack cards. So we're going to take those out.
Take a moment there, get a little better light in here.
Okay, so the defense cards will get shuffled in. The attack cards, the generic cards here, do have some other iconography on them. If you have a hand grenade that shows up here, then what that means is you will roll die, and if a 12 or greater is rolled, an event will happen. Random event. And this is an option you can add in if you want to. And there's a random event table. You roll two dice then and determine which event happens, so it keeps it kind of fresh. There is also a lot of cards are blank. There it is. I should have stacked the deck before I showed you. So there's also this icon here, which is to reshuffle. So on a 6 or greater, you're going to reshuffle and you roll the dice. Now, for the AI, some more icons they have is they do have die at the top of each. So when you're playing, instead of rolling die for the AI, you wish, you can burn through the cards a little more, because you won't really ever go through the whole deck, especially with this few counters. So you can do their die rolls using that. Got a 2, got a 3. And you would not pay attention to any of this. Any of the orders, you're only using it for the die roll. So you wouldn't reshuffle with a reshuffle icon, anything like that. If an event occurs, it occurs before you resolve the card. If a reshuffle occurs, it occurs after you resolve the card. So you finish out the card, then you reshuffle. I tend to just do die roll because I'm just old fashioned and I don't want this. Obviously has a finite. If I'm gonna play where my die rolls are random, then I want theirs to be random. I don't want them to come from a stacked pool. So when you're playing for the AI, and then I haven't shuffled this yet, obviously, but I don't know what this bottom card is, so we'll just take a look at it here. So let's say it was AI's turn. And it would be in this case, because the British had the initiative to start this game. You flip the card over. Okay. We do have an event. So we roll 11 or greater. Turn the event. We got an 8. No event. There's no modifiers on that. It's just a quirky thing. And you don't have to use that if you don't want to. So now we have you follow the order just like the, if you're familiar with the Conflict of Heroes, you do it the same thing, top to bottom. So first thing is your priority. If there's any AEO unit within one hex of a player unit, then if the firepower is greater than the target, you're going to fire. I don't get too bogged down in the specifics of this one. We'll do that when we're doing the run-through, but just showing how it works. So you check this. If nobody's within one range, then you go. If anybody's within two range, you'll do that. And then the next step is, in this case, number of activatable AEOs, which is the AI units, less than activatable player units. We've got a typo there, obviously. Then the AEO passes. And in this case, like if this were the start of the game, and I was actually hand-drawing this card, obviously nobody's starting within one, nobody's starting within two. And to start with, since I'll be the Germans, I have more units. So they would pass. All right? And so it would take its turn and go from there. So then you keep working your way down. So let's say that wasn't the case. You go to the next one. Now your secondary orders. The AEO closest to a target. Do a dynamic move towards. Now, what on earth does that mean? Well, that's where the flowcharts come in handy. So, let's see. First of all, there's a chart for dynamic solo movement stances. So here we have dynamic movement of an SMC or MMC. Okay. So it's going to tell you this generic instruction as to how they want to move. If they're going to do low crawl, stealth, or assault, or just regular movement. The AI will always attempt to move from hex to hex, avoiding opportunity fire whenever possible. So if they were the Germans and they were moving across, they would do their best to maintain cover, stay out of line of sight, whenever possible, because once they move, they're obviously spotted. So you've got that, but then you've also got, take these cards out of the way, but it's a pretty thick stack. You have 5 flowcharts. I don't think I can zoom out enough to get this. They are color-coded. Movement is green. So you have movement flowchart. And if the AI is defensive, you use the defensive side. The offensive side is on the other. And then you start, you find the condition that applies and resolve. So is the AO in hex with a positive terrain modifier? They're already in the hex. And is this the old one? I thought this was a typo. If the AEO is in a hex with a positive terrain modifier, why would we, if they are, why would we move toward terrain modifier? Seems like this yes and no is backwards. But maybe I'm just not understanding something. Player unit closer to victory condition or map edge. Yes, and then go to the next order. No, the AO moves a unit or stack towards the victory condition. And see, that's where it starts getting kind of, for me, getting a little funky. These guys are sitting here, right? And somebody run to the sheet here. They're sitting here, and they're going to be waiting on me to come at them. So it seems like they would never move in a defensive posture until they had a reason to, like they were backing up to cover or something like that. Or didn't want to be engaged. So it gets kind of weird here. There is no indicator as to which of these. It's basically just choose a condition that applies and resolves. Is the AO cut off from the victory condition? In that case, no. Move on. Otherwise, they try to move towards it. Do they have units off the map? That's for when you start out. When all the units are off the map, they may then move in. And then here it gets a little random. You die roll, and you get to you pick these. But you still have to pick them, and that's what starts getting kind of weird. You know, not weird, just, and they can't, being a programmer, I'm going to say code, they can't code for this. They can't anticipate every scenario in which units are available and priority order of which to pick and stuff like that. But in the end, when it comes down to like one multi-man counter, right, it's like, well, which one do I pick? I mean, I got to pick what's best for them, but at that point, am I not playing the AI? I'm not making decisions for the AI and choosing those things. And then there's the issue of when they come in, like if they're coming off the map, then I get to pick where they come from. Do I think it's best for them to come down here toward this side or up here toward this side? I mean, I really don't want to, I'm not ragging on it because I think it does a lot of good. I mean, it's no less, it's definitely a bit more advanced than a chip pull would be of like, you know, here's this unit. But it seems like there's still a lot of decisions that the player has to make for the enemy. And you get to that point, where's the line where it's like, I'm playing the AI versus I'm just playing myself with some mitigating factors in there. I don't know. So anyway, other gamers may find that it contributes enough to their solo experience that they're fine with it. And, you know, I've hesitated doing a demo of this because I feel like I'm not getting something. But that may be a valuable data point. Other gamers may be at my level where they may not get it either. And it'll be really helpful when this is finally released and the community comes out with advice and input and videos and, you know, ask questions and answers questions and so on and so forth. But I'm really worried that I'm missing something, that I'm the inept one here. But I'm just going to present it. You'll see it. And you may scream and throw things at your screen. But it's, I don't have the benefit that a lot of y'all are going to have of seeing other people make the mistakes and having a pool to ask questions of. So I hope you'll take that into consideration. So back to the flowcharts. So there's 5 of these. There's move, fire, victory conditions. What's that one called? execute victory conditions, there's counteractions, so on and so forth. And they're huge. They're huge. So here's the defensive counteraction sheet. So I got to have the defensive movement sheet. I got to have the fire defensive sheet. I got to have all these sheets. They're huge, right? Which is fine. I think they should have included them smaller. Since this is kind of like a preview review, that's my input. That's my, I love the guys at Lock and Load, but my input is that that's too huge for you're playing solo. You know, I don't want to take up my table with a whole bunch of charts, flow charts, when they could have been smaller. So, to that end, and these are not included with the game, I scanned them in. I scanned each half of the page, and then in Photoshop, I pieced them together. They're not perfect. They don't align exactly, but they do enough that I can read them, and if I have any question, then I can always go back to the full flow chart. And the other benefit is, this is the defensive sheet. I took all the defensive ones and put them back to back on one card and laminated it. So now I'll use this for in-game play. And I just think it'd be nice if something like this were included, or at the very least, take the flowchart and do it like this. So it's one page. And then you get these smaller cards. Like those smaller cards? These smaller cards. I think it's great that people as gamers get older, they may need more reading ability of larger print, but sometimes it's impractical. And that's just my opinion, obviously. But I did this, and it definitely makes it a lot easier to refer to it. For those that were asking about modern, there's a flowchart for helicopters. So when you get into the Vietnam and the modern games, you will have those as well. So I did that so there's a defensive one, I did an offensive one, and then there's some that are this is fire, combined fire, the events table. I went ahead and did because I had room. And then I took a couple of sheets just from the Heroes of Normandy game, the terrain charts, which is also a double-sided chart, and just some turn summary, things like that. And just put them on there as a ready reference, so I'm not always having to continually flip out the big charts every time. I just need to refer to it for something. And again, if I can look it up, I will do so. So anyway, all my chart flipping here has messed these guys up. So that is pretty much the setup. I've got the deck of cards So I'm going to shuffle these up, and hopefully I remember the rules. It's been a while since I've played full games of Lone Tactical, and I've tried and started the solo a few times, and I keep getting confused, but I'm going to just take my time. I'm going to get through it and see how it plays and go forward from there. Hopefully, I won't make any too glaringly obvious mistakes. Hopefully, I won't make any mistakes, but hopefully, you won't catch them. Actually, I like when you catch them and tell me. I am not perfect by any means, as my wife will attest. So, gonna set this deck up, and we'll step through it in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.